I don't want to put sunglasses on because it's, you know, it's too,
too
much.
Cool for school.
It's too much.
I'm going to Cannes with my first film,
and here I am.
Here I am
in a car with sunglasses.
Uber cool.
Yeah.
Hey. So, how old are you?
I'm 35.
Dare I ask?
35.
You're 35, so you're a grown up.
Yeah, I'm a grown up.
Well, you know, you read first time filmmaker, you always think, you know, you're 17 and a half and, you know,
yeah,
just got out of school and you look young enough, you know.
Well, thank you. I appreciate
Is that a good thing now that you're 35?
That is.
Not as good when you were 22 and couldn't get served, but
right.
Now that you're 35, it's a good thing.
Yeah, no, at the time it was a problem. It was like when I was, you know, 21, looking young, I can remember being, you know, outside of a bar and giving them my license and them not believing me. You know, I'd have to like actually, you know, say like, you need to call someone, this is not fake, this is real. So, but no, now that I'm 35, yeah, it's cool.
Well, the French will let you drink at 6, so you're okay.
Yes, yes.
You know, you can, they put it in their milk with the, where the babies are born. So what was your journey to get to your first film at 35?
Well, you know, just to get the movie made, Adela and I, my producer, we've been working towards this film for, you know, 4 or 5 years, honestly. And I started, like, I wrote the first draft of this script a long time ago, like in probably 8 years ago, I wrote the script.
And is it your story? Is it your childhood?
A little bit. In some ways it is. There's probably a little bit of me in all the characters to some degree, but it's not autobiographical.
Right.
No, but it's, you know, it's like inspired by things that I remember, and then some of it is stuff that I kind of wish had happened, you know, when I was that age. And, you know, it's a mixture.
One of the funny things about the movie is that it's so, it feels very period and yet is current, clearly. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are piercings and all that stuff,
yeah.
And then there's also this kind of, you know, 70s, Dazed and Confused, you know, era feeling also. Mm-hmm. And you don't really, you know, but you don't really know.
I mean, when it is,
yeah.
Yeah, we mixed a lot of different elements into it so that, you know, there's some things that look like they're late 70s and stuff that's mid 80s. And, you know, some of the clothing might be, you know, maybe some of it's more current. There's cars from different periods. And we kind of try to make it so it would feel like a mixture of all these time periods, so you couldn't quite put your finger on it. It's been nice. Seems like people are responding to that. I didn't want it to feel like a movie about people right now. Although I wanted, you know, someone who's younger that watches the film to be able to relate to it, because I feel like the clothing and some of those things are not necessarily what makes us, you know, connect to that point in our lives. It's really,
so you wrote it in your mid-20s. Did you
mid-late 20s, yeah.
So did you have to, like, go back and make sure that you were up to date with what kids were feeling, or we just assume that, I mean, I assume the kids pretty much suffer the way we did. You know, 10 years older than you.
Yeah, it wasn't really my concern about what someone is, exactly how people are, you know, younger people are feeling at this moment. I kind of just trusted that, that is a universal experience, and just went with how I remembered it. And, you know, I hope that that's true. It seems like it is.
So you were out looking for money. I interrupted your story earlier.
Yeah.
And it was just, people just showed up and said, please have a bag of money because we love movies.
Yeah. And Adela and I, we became bank robbers. No, I mean, it was hard. I mean, that's the thing is I got out of film school, went to Florida State for grad school, moved out here, and just started working. And I, you know, was writing scripts and trying to get a film made. That's a really hard thing to do.
So you're from Florida?
Originally from Michigan, but I went to Florida State for grad school.
Okay. Why Florida State?
I'd heard they had a really good film program. One of my professors that I went to Wayne State in Detroit for undergrad, he was pretty cool with the dean there, and he had recommended it to me, and I got in, and I went there, and it was a really good experience. Like, most of the people who worked on the film with me, my producer, my editor, our cinematographer, our associate producers, I mean, just a long list of people, they all went to school there. So,
and they're spread out from, I guess, all over the country?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Nobody's actually from Tallahassee.
You know, a couple of them are, I think. Yeah. I think some are. Most of them are. My producer's from Florida. Mm-hmm. Adela is from Florida, but not Tallahassee. But no, they're from everywhere. Yeah.
So ultimately, how did the money come together? Did you find one person or a bunch of 10 people or 100 people?
Yeah, you know, some of it was a little bit of, donations and that, you know, a lot of begging. Mm-hmm. A lot of
begging's sort
of,
always good.
Yeah, I learned to beg. A lot of personal sacrifice from me and mm-hmm. the other people involved. And then the truth is just a lot of hours of our own time mm-hmm. to sort of make up for, you know, a lack of money.
So did you say, okay, I'm going to cast people that are not, you know, not even try to cast famous people? Or was that just not an option of the budget range?
I never wanted to. There was, mm-hmm. we talked about it at times. For me, I always thought that the film would be a better film if we cast people that, you know, an audience had never seen before. Mm-hmm. Because I thought that they would, be able to put themselves into those characters and imagine that being them mm-hmm. If they weren't looking at someone that, you know, that they knew really well, that was famous and in a lot of magazines and films. And but we did talk about mm-hmm. you know, maybe trying to find some bigger name actors, and you know, ultimately I was really happy that we everyone sort of got on board with us finding unknowns, and that was also difficult, truthfully, to find those people.
Just because casting people who are not, were they not experienced actors, I guess, or are they?
Most of them were not. There are a few that are in the film. I don't want to say that no one is an actor, but most of them, it was the first film that they'd ever been in. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
And was that intentional, or was that? So you were really looking for kind of people who are raw and...
Brand new.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So was this a Linkletter influence, or what was the inspiration?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I love Linkletter. Like, Dazed and Confused is great. And I guess
all those people are famous now, so it's ironic.
Oh, all the people in the film. Yeah, no, for sure.
Dazed and Confused, yeah.
It's a little bit of that, but also just the tone that I wanted with the film. I thought that it would... Mm-hmm. There would be an element of something more natural if the people weren't experienced actors. Mm. So
do you make a film like this thinking, okay, this is going to, I mean, it's your first film, you take years and years to get it together,
mm-hmm.
and are you thinking about what its place at the table is going to be, or how it fits into film land, or are you just trying to get your piece of work made?
Well, I mean, when you're doing this, the only thing I can think of is just trying to finish it,
right.
Trying to get it done. You know, it's not really up to me. I'm really proud of the movie. I feel like, I feel like we did what we set out to do, and I'm happy about that. And I hope that other people like it and enjoy it.
But are you thinking, okay, we have to get into Sundance, or we have to get into South by Southwest, or this is...
Well, I mean, we were hoping to play festivals for sure, because there's so many movies that are made, and it's really hard to get noticed and to have people see it. I mean, mm-hmm. When we finished the film, I was like, I'm really happy this is done and that we did what we wanted, and I, on some level, I feel content that it's mm-hmm. finished and I like it. But then there's the other part of you that want people to see it,
yeah.
That's why you make the movie in the first place, and so we were really happy when we got into South by Southwest, mm-hmm. and that was.
Had you made the run at Sundance, or was that?
No, you know, that we thought that maybe we would go there, but mm-hmm. Adela always felt very strongly that South by was the right festival mm-hmm. for this film.
It does make sense.
Yeah, and I think she was right. Mm-hmm. And so we're really happy about that. And I don't know, Austin was a really cool experience. It was really amazing. Yeah.
Did you have expectations going in? Had you been to South by? Or?
I'd never been before, mm-hmm. no. I mean, I talked to a lot of other like friends and other filmmakers that have been, and they said it's a really fun time, mm-hmm. and really, really cool, receptive audiences. And that was the case, yeah. I was really nervous before our first screening, and it seemed to go really well.
Which theater was your first screening?
The Alamo Ritz.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a, what's, it has the service and everything, the food service.
Oh yeah.
Like the other one in town.
Yeah.
So Full House, I assume.
Uh-huh. Yep.
And did they kind of have a sense of what was coming, or did you feel like it was just complete blank slate for them and they just were coming for
the audience? Well, you know, we got a decent amount of like a little bit of preview press and stuff, especially locally. And it seemed like people were pretty excited about the movie. Mm-hmm. We had, there was a, you know, a lot of, as it was the case for a lot of the films and the competition films at South By, there was, there was a lot of people showing up. Like they've definitely, not everyone got in. You know, it was pretty cool to see a big line around the block.
And your cast there? Did you have many people?
Some of them. Most of them weren't able to come. We had a few that were that were there, and they were really excited. It was neat.
And I assume you had not done any test screening before that?
No.
You guys weren't really in the business of test screening?
No. You know, I mean, before that, I think it was probably maybe like a room of like 12 people, you know, that saw it. That was it.
So you were a little nervous?
I was nervous, yeah.
So what moment did you know that you had the audience?
You know, there's just a few scenes where I could tell people were laughing in the right places, and there was just a mood in the room that felt really good, and I kind of relaxed and just, and I really enjoyed it. That first screening was really nice, and then afterwards, you know, talking to people and everyone coming up and asking about, you know, about things in the movie and telling me their feelings about it, it felt very genuine, and I kind of understood that. That people liked it.
So are you watching the film at that point, or are you watching the audience?
A little of both.
And when they ordered their extra beer or whatever, you're kinda, is that nerve-wracking when you're in that theater, or is it?
Oh, you mean the waiters crossing?
Getting waiters and
you know, there's
the
moments.
Sanctity of cinema.
Right. You know what? I went with it. I had a beer myself, and it was cool.
So did things, had you do it, at that point, had you already applied to go to Cannes or send it to somebody? Or
you know, just... I think we had. Adela took care of that. My producer had sent it in. You know, truthfully, I didn't. You know, I always dreamed of something like that, but I didn't really. I didn't spend a lot of time thinking about that because it just felt like such a. You know, it feels like a kind of a long shot sort of thing. So I didn't spend a lot of time thinking about it. But when I got word. I was amazed. So
what do you, is there any, do you have perspective? Can you have perspective this soon after you've finished the film? When did you actually lock down the film?
We didn't lay off the final film until maybe a week or two before South By. So not that long ago.
So you were really, it was still fresh. And it's only, we're only now about a month and a half after South By.
Yeah, I mean, I was sort of just kind of starting to balance out after Austin, and then we got word about Cannes.
So do you feel like you're going to be unbalanced again? Or
yes, I currently am. No, I mean, you know, it's a lot, and it's wonderful, but it's a lot of stuff.
Do you have, you know, filmmakers telling you and friends who are filmmakers who have been had through that experience telling you about what to expect? Or
A little bit. I mean... most of my friends haven't. I have a few friends that have been to Cannes for, you know, during the festival, and I've definitely talked to them. But not that many that have had films in Cannes. Not too many of my friends. So I haven't really talked to too many people about that. Adela has talked to some other producers, you know, that have had films there. You know, and I'm starting to meet more and more people that have gone through that experience, but not too much.
So do you feel like you're part of the... the movement, I guess, that gets called mumblecore, gets called, God knows what it is these days.
I don't think we're a mumblecore film. I don't think so. I don't know. I don't think anyone has said that yet. I don't know. Wait, do you think that it is?
It's funny. I mean, it's like mumblecore from before mumblecore. It doesn't feel like specifically like an improvised, you know, film with a bunch of friends who got together and know each other already and you know establish something. But on the other hand, I guess, you know, kind of like everybody now blends in together what, you know, blogs are. Everything on the web is a blog.
Right, right.
Somehow everything that is young and chatty in any way is somehow mumblecore.
I don't know. I guess I don't personally see that. But if other people...
I mean, Aaron Carrots isn't necessarily mumblecore either, but is, you know...
Oh, you mean the, like, Cold Weather? And
yeah.
That? Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I think that we're trying to do... I think I guess often when I think of mumblecore, you know, I think about much more dialogue driven than our film is. I think we were trying to do something that, like, you know, there's whole scenes that are you know, very very image based, you know, sort of close up point of view kind of stuff, and I think that that is maybe not part of that movement, but I can see that. I can see there's probably some connections. Yeah.
So what are your influences?
Well, I have a lot. I'm a huge film buff, and, you know, like most filmmakers.
From childhood?
Yeah. My favorite filmmaker is probably Truffaut, and that's sort of my idol. And
so, how did you first see Truffaut?
Well, you know, my mom rented some Truffaut stuff when I was younger. I know I saw it's like 400 Blows and Small Change, and and then there was the CBC channel. I grew up in Michigan, just outside Detroit, so we got the Canadian channel.
Oh, those Canadians!
Know. Yeah, and so I would always watch the. They played a lot of European films and French films late at night on CBC. So I'd always watch those. So that's where I saw like the rest of the Dwinelle series, like Love on the Run, and I don't know.
You didn't have to wait to film school. You actually had an education.
I saw those
in
when
film.
I saw that stuff when I was younger. Yeah. And I loved it. So, you know, that's in terms of like tone and character. That stuff is something that I kind of strive for, but I also love you know, a lot of, you know, genre films, and you know, it's the, like, our film is definitely I'd say the spine of it is very inspired by you know, movies like American Graffiti and Dazed and Confused and those but my idea was to take that kind of spine and to give it, like, add scenes that were a little slower and a little softer, more gentle, that that kind of again are more inspired by, like, French New Wave films. So that was, is kind of me mixing those two together, and that was the attempt anyway.
And had you seen all those kind of films on television, or had you had a chance to go to the movie theater at some point? And
as an adult, I've seen a lot of that stuff in the theater, but you know, in, like, revival houses and stuff, but you know, when I was younger, it was TV and then VHS and then DVD. And
was there revival house, good revival houses in Detroit?
You know,
or
yeah,
in South
the a little bit.
We don't have good ones in LA. We only have one in LA, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's more like you know, there would be stuff at the Detroit Film Theater sometimes. You know, it's not all the time, but you know, when you're looking for it, you can find it.
So was there encouragement for you to join film culture? Was your mom,
my family,
all about it? Yeah.
Yeah, they were pretty supportive, actually. Both my parents, I think they've always been really supportive of sort of whatever I wanted to do. I think there's probably times that they worry, you know, but I think that's any parent. But no, they've been, I think they really like it, and they both, my parents and some of my family came out to Austin for South By, and that was really nice for them. They came to, like, the premiere screening, and it was really exciting for them. I know.
So you
that
didn't get the lifetime, the childhood of get a real job. Oh, you got to get a real job.
No, they were, you know, I mean, I think they're just happy that I've, you know, been able to support myself and make a living, and that I'm doing. Or trying to do the things that I care about.
And so. What about when you were 30? Did they get nervous? Did you get nervous?
Oh, was it, you mean, like, well, I mean, some people in my family.
Well, it's a different question. Yeah, so yeah. You know, there's, like, the childhood thing of.
And then it's kind of like, hey, wait, why aren't you? You haven't done this yet. Sure, for sure. You know, I think. Sorry, it's a weird bug. I think, you know, like, my grandparents, I know they, for them, when we were making the film, they were kind of like, well, you know, are you sure you shouldn't be buying a house instead? and that's hard, you know, that's hard to hear, but I guess it's, I'm just one of those people that this is what I care about, and if I'm not doing it, then I don't know. I know that I won't be happy unless I'm trying to do the things.
Did
that
you
mean
ever
a lot
question
to me.
It? I mean, did you ever get to the point where you went, I don't know about this, is maybe not such a good idea?
No. I know, no, that sounds strange, but no. No, I don't think I ever have. Because I think if I had, I probably wouldn't have continued trying to do it.
Have you been in LA through a lot of it, or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been in LA since I moved here the end of 2002 after grad school, and I've just been out here working with my friends, and you know, I really enjoy Los Angeles. I like it here a lot, and I think when I first moved out here, I thought that I, you know, probably like a lot of people, I thought that I would be making. I thought I'd be making a feature within, you know, a year.
Right.
Like I thought, oh, it's going to happen right away. You know, I'd done a lot of short films and stuff that seemed to get a lot of attention and people really responded to. And, you know, and then there's the reality of it's a lot harder than that. And I think I sort of wish that maybe it had dawned on me sooner that to do this, you kind of have to do it yourself on some level. I mean, I'm not saying everyone does, but I think that there's a lot of truth in that. Like, until you sort of put the energy forward and push yourself to, you know, to create what you want to create without the approval of other people, then I think that's what it takes.
Yeah.
And I think that took me a couple years to realize. And then once I did, it still took several years to actually do it.
Yeah.
So.
No, I had an argument recently with somebody about women in film, and I do feel like there was a very real glass ceiling 10 years ago, 15 years ago. But at this point, I kind of feel like, you know, if you want to do it, you just got to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only real answer there is. You know, it is. There are things that are harder for women, but there are things that are hard for men too. And, you know, a lot of it is just going ahead and being the person who's going to persevere and make something happen.
Right.
I mean, it's not, talking about it ain't going to make it happen in this business for anybody.
Yeah.
So commitment is, you know, seems to be the key thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So did you have a day job during the?
Yeah, I still do.
So that completely away from film, or is it a film related?
No, I work at my day job. I work as an editor, cutting like TV commercials and that, like movie marketing stuff.
Huh.
So. Mm-hmm.
So, have you come up with a genius TV spot for your movie already?
Well, we have a trailer. I don't know if you've seen it, but. A good friend of mine who I work with cut that. I mean, I sat with him and we worked on it together, but he cut it, and I'm really happy with it. So yeah, we spent quite a bit of time doing it a few months ago, so that was sort of thanks to my job.
So are you a better editor or better director?
I don't want to get myself in trouble at work. I'm a better director.
Well, this is kind of the dream.
The truth is, I'm a better director. Yeah, I'm a really good editor, but I'm a better director. Yeah.
But this is kind of the dream of every one of those guys and women who are, they're cutting trailers.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
not everyone, but
a lot of them.
Yeah, a lot. Yeah.
I mean, I guess eventually it becomes the job as opposed to something you're doing until you're waiting for something else to happen. But
right. Yeah.
So are you getting a lot of encouragement from those guys?
They're really happy. Yeah. The people at my work are really happy for me. It's been cool. Yeah.
It's rather exhilarating.
It feels nice. It was really, yeah, it's very nice.
And so have you had a screening for them?
Not yet. I think they want to do one, and I think we're going to try and set something up after Cannes.
Mm-hmm.
So
you're still cutting as a way to make a living.
Yeah.
Because you probably haven't made a fortune on the movie yet.
Nope.
And have you guys gone through has there been a buyer yet? Is there somebody sitting around waiting?
That, it looks very positive. I can't say too much, but you know, we have our domestic and our international sales agents, and they're all working on that. So it looks very, very promising. So
do you sweat that market at this point, or is that Adela's issue and you just hope for the best? I mean, everybody's talking about the indie film business being kind of rough at the moment, and the theatricals being tough.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard all that. I don't know. I just want to be positive about it, and we'll see what happens. I can't really control that, you know. So we have a really good team of people sort of working on it, and a lot of and the response to the movie has been very strong so far. So I don't know. We'll see what happens.
Do you feel like you have a better position from which to kind of have a sense of it because you are close to the business side by doing what you do as a day job, or? Is that just a different animal completely?
I think they're a little different. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think I see it. I definitely understand, you know, I understand the sort of marketing side of it, just from my work.
Mm-hmm.
But as for the what it is to actually have a film that's, you know, going out to festivals and that, you know, will hopefully, you know, be sold and put in, you know, and be in theaters or in DVD and Blu-ray and all that, that's a different thing. Mm-hmm. So, no, I'm just sort of getting up to speed with it.
So if somebody picks it up and decides they want to do a twins campaign, all about the twins. Are you, I mean, as a young filmmaker, have you, you know, put your mark in the sand and said, okay, that ain't going to happen. I'm committed to the artistic merit of the work, or yeah. Are you kind of dealing with which foot to put place first?
Well, I mean, my immediate reaction is that I'm protective of the film. Mm-hmm. and of what it, you know, what it means to people, and you know, I mean, I understand the other side of it too, but I don't know. We'll see. Hopefully it's not one extreme or the other.
Yeah. So are you starting on the next idea? Have you been writing it up for the last 3.5 years?
Yeah, I know. I it's funny. I have a bunch of stuff written, but the one that I want to do next, I'm finishing the script now for that. So, mm-hmm. Adele and I are already planning that.
A spiritual cousin to this one, or
no, it's
further away?
A little different. You know, I think I'll probably come back and do more things that are along the lines of like coming of age film, but mm-hmm. I don't want the next one to be that. The next one follows a young woman in her 20s after she breaks up with sort of a long-term boyfriend, and it's about follows her for a day and her experiences after that. So it's going to be a really pretty sweet little story. I don't want to say too much, but mm-hmm. I'm really excited about it.
So you understand women?
I guess. You know what? I don't, but I do. You know, not necessarily in my personal life, but in terms of a film, I think it seems like that. Yeah, mm. At least people say so.
Is it the lack of necessary understanding in real life that that makes you explore the idea
of
it?
It may be a motivation. I don't know what I'm doing personally, but otherwise, you know. No, I mean, maybe a little bit.
You need research assistance.
Yes.
So if the studio comes to you, if Universal comes to you after this and says, you know, we need you to make American Pie 7, mm-hmm. is that something that interests you? Or do you have the sellout button on you that you want to push at some point?
It's just such a hard question. I mean, I want to make films that I care about and believe in. Mm-hmm. And it's, as for what that is, you know, I know that I will... 100% I know that I will continue to make movies that I write and that.
So can you imagine writing directing
but I,
somebody
but
else's
I,
script?
I could imagine directing someone else's script. It just uh-huh. depends on what it is. Yeah. I mean, and without a specific example, I can't say. I think I'm probably drawn to think to the idea of, you know, making a movie is a lot of time, it's a lot of work, and I want to believe in it. I want to know that I can do a good job with it. Mm-hmm. A lot of the time I think that'll be things that I write, but I am open to something else. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But just
and directing is number one for you. You're not going to be off doing script rewrites and things like that, or maybe you will.
I mean, I like writing too, but mm-hmm. directing, I like directing.
What about it turns you on?
You know, I feel, I don't know, I think it's just I can tell that it's a strength of mine. It's something that I feel confident and comfortable doing. Mm-hmm. The only reason that I want to make films in the first place is because I think probably why most people, maybe this isn't true, but at least for myself, it's because I feel like I have some stories and some things that I feel like, you know, won't exist if I don't try and do them. And mm-hmm. I want to create some things that mean something to me and that I think might mean something to other people. Mm-hmm. And I think that I can do that by directing it. And I think that if I were to just write a script, I don't think that that my particular tone or approach to it would exist. I don't mm-hmm. think someone else would do it. And so that's kind of why I like directing.
Did you like genre movies that are not, you know, that are... You like dumb movies too?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I love. Well, I don't think they're dumb, but I love horror films. I love science mm-hmm. fiction. You know, I love a ton of stuff. I mean, I Like I said, I'm a huge film buff. I love a lot of silent films. You know, boy, I don't know. My favorite movie is Rear Window. I love Hitchcock. So I want to do a lot of stuff. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I guess that's a great question with Hitchcock. Was he, you know, primarily an auteur, or was he a genre director who just knocked stuff out that had his signature, obviously, yeah, but also was, special.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. All I can say is that that I love a lot of his films, and Rear Window's one that I watch pretty regularly, and I can't get enough of it. Was he an auteur? Yeah, sure. Yeah, yeah.
So do you see? Are you interested in that kind of construction yourself? I mean, are you?
Gosh, you know, that's like dangerous territory.
Well, obviously, you don't want to compete with Rear Window. Nobody should have.
Yeah,
to.
Yeah, no, I can't. I want to. I mean, I think that. For me, the things that I enjoy in film, it does mean more than. To me, it is more than just an entertainment. Yeah, if mm-hmm. that's sort of what you're asking. Yeah.
So what are you expecting when you get off the plane? I guess we're going Monday or Tuesday?
Oh, yeah, I'm leaving Tuesday. I get there Wednesday, I think. Yeah. What am I expecting? I don't know. I'm going to be with a lot of friends, and a lot of our crew is going. Some of the cast is going to be there. I think I already have a pretty detailed schedule that I haven't really looked at yet. I'm just going to try and go with it and enjoy it. I honestly don't know what to expect. I'm going to watch my movie a lot. I know that.
Do you mind watching it over? Do you enjoy watching it over and over again? Or,
yeah, I do with an audience. It's just I've seen the movie a lot.
Yeah.
It's not that I like the film, but, there's a point.
And now you're getting phone calls.
Yeah.
So you'll watch it with the audience there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And will you live and die by that moment, or do you kind of feel like you already know where you are with it?
I feel like I know. I mean, I feel like I feel like I know where we're at with it. I mean, again, obviously, I'm looking forward to hearing and to seeing how people react to it there. But honestly, just this is a small film for us, and. Although it's like years of work, at the same time, this is a big cool thing to have happen, and getting this movie into Critics Week, that's like victory for me right there. I'm no matter what, I'm happy with that. So
tuxedo,
yeah, got one,
bought one, rented one,
bought one.
Okay,
yep.
What who are you going to be wearing?
Oh, I don't know. Somebody else picked it out for me.
Okay, somebody male or somebody female?
Female.
Oh, good idea. So it's been vetted.
I'm asking everyone else's opinion. Yeah, I don't trust myself at all.
Okay.
In terms of clothing. Yeah.